Don't Feed the Bully by Brad Tassell. Published by Lasat Publishing, an imprint of And Books. I am Hannibal Greatneck III, and I am a detective. My job is to watch, to observe human nature, and see things that no one else sees, finding hidden clues until the pattern of evidence points to one conclusion, thus unraveling the mystery and solving what no one else could solve. Chapter 1. My greatest case started as no case at all. The case I call Don't Feed the Bully started on my first day as a transfer student at William B. Travis Elementary School. Bells should have rung in my head immediately, but it wasn't until weeks later that I realized the connection. Colonel William B. Travis was the commander of the Alamo in 1836, where he and 187 other men fought off Santa Ana and 2,999 other bullies for 10 days before being overrun like a golf cart in a demolition derby. I should have figured it. Any school with such a namesake could have a warped sense of dealing with bullies and make sure to stop any present-day Santa Anas from overrunning them. Ending my elementary school career at William Travis in Mrs. Austin's sixth-grade class was not my plan. Dad was changing jobs, and I needed to follow my meal ticket, as 11-year-old detectives don't rake in the kind of dough needed to satisfy a root beer and Cheeto habit that kept my dentist on his toes and my fingertips consistently pale orange. It didn't take a master sleuth to spot the first major difference in Mrs. Austin's classroom from any other in my previous elementary career. I am not talking about the pair of hard hazel eyes, tight curly red hair, pasty white skin, and serious prepubescent acne standing directly in front of me like a pint-sized border guard as I walked through the door. "I am Kurt Pesterman," he said in a tone that stunk of superiority, as if judging people was Kurt's hobby and I was a new project. "I welcome you to William B. Travis Elementary." The welcome was as empty as a free milk bowl in Cattown. "I am president of the WBT Agitator Awareness Society. And you are?" I figured being new, I shouldn't make waves in the first 30 seconds in a classroom. I'd be spending the next 132 weekdays with time off for Christmas, spring break, and a possible two-day stomach flu I was planning for late January during the 48-hour Sam Spade marathon on the Sleuth Channel. I calmly gave my name. Hannibal Greatneck III. Friends call me Handy. "Well, Mr. Greatneck," he said, as if only what he said was important, and being friends was a condition of me knowing that importance. "You aren't big enough to be a physical threat, so I will just let you know we also don't tolerate verbal bullying either." Kurt smiled a row of pickled yellow teeth that seemed to flinch when exposed as if they rarely saw the light. "There are severe penalties for breaking the code of respectful conduct in this class and the school." All of this explained the observation, which I had not yet finished before I was confronted by WBT's agitator welcoming committee. A cage. An actual cage was sitting in the middle of the classroom. A desk sat in the center, and all the other desks were around the outside mocking the virus that they found a way to tolerate. "That is where Ralphie sits," Kurt said, as if the Agitator Awareness Society was also dabbling in mind reading. "Ralphie a chimpanzee?" "More like a gorilla," Kurt Pesterman said in a smirking tone, as if he'd made a joke, but laughing was beneath him. "Ralphie has strong bullying tendencies." "Tendencies?" I asked. "Pushing kids down, intimidating smaller kids. He used to take food from other kids' trays in the lunchroom. That's why the sign." I looked up at the cage and couldn't believe it had escaped me before. In bold purple letters across a bright pink sign over the front of the cage were the words, "Don't feed the bully." "That sign reminds Ralphie what he's not supposed to do." As I said, penalties. Kurt, I could see, was very proud of himself and added, "I call it literal motivation." Ralphie lumbered in as if he'd been waiting in the hall for someone to say penalties before he could enter. He was huge for 12, and he grumbled to himself as he pushed the chairs out of the way. The other students who had been filing in during Pesterman's and my chat froze, possum caught in the bat signal. A wave of fear swept the room as Ralphie heaved his massive, hulking person inside the cage and shut the door with a slam that echoed penitentiary off every wall. Within seconds, things went back to normal. It could have been because I was new, but the fear from the class registered 15 out of 10 on the overreaction scale. It looked like they were all trained to flinch at Ralphie's every move. Ralphie was big, but I'd seen a lot meaner. And yet nobody had ever shown the kind of terror I'd seen in the eyes of my new classmates. Was Ralphie what they were afraid of, or did his presence remind them of something else? Isn't this a little severe for fingering a few tater tots? I spit out as I realized I'd put my foot so far in my mouth I could have performed a tonsillectomy with my Nike swoosh. Kurt Pesterman's mood turned in an instant from Grandma to Big Bad Wolf, and I was Little Red. His eyes and manner became severe.
Well, Mr. Greatneck III, if you had been the butt of the bully's wrath, had you suffered innumerable cosmic wedgies, had you tasted the degradation of a swirly, had you stood by in horror as Mr. Crumblebean was torn apart before your eyes to a symphony of laughter, and seen the devastation that it can wreak, you would not be as flippant with your diagnosis.
Kurt's veins began to burn a brilliant blue right through the skin of his neck and forehead like a 3D roadmap. His face began to battle his hair for the reddest thing on his head. I could tell Kurt had spent some time being bullied, probably mercilessly, and now that he held the upper hand, he was not conceding an inch. I just wondered if maybe he was enjoying this power a little too much.
Sorry, man, I said, looking around the room at 23 faces that were staring at me with the same kind of fear and trepidation reserved for Scooby-Doo and Shaggy the first time the swamp monster shows up near the mystery machine. I suddenly wasn't sure who they feared more, Ralphie or Kurt. I snapped back with my most sheepish, aw shucks, humble pie voice. Hey, it's my first day, and I don't know what's happening. I just want to make friends. I guess I read a lot of Encyclopedia Brown books, and I ask a lot of questions that don't need answers. The color, or more precisely, the lack of color, returned to Kurt's face as the redness of his temper faded like a stress bruise. His veins sunk slowly back below skin level, little submarines waiting for their next trip up to the surface. Kurt spoke in a tense but guarded tone.
Since it's your first day, Mr. Greatneck, I will let that little slip go as a sign of ignorance. But watch yourself, as we do not treat agitators lightly.
That part was as clear as simple addition to a college senior. But I was a little sketchy on the criteria the we use to separate the agitators from the detectives. As Mrs. Austin entered the room, the class took their seats, and Kurt went over to meet our teacher like a terrier that hadn't seen its owner in months and might wet the rug with excitement. Things settled down to a pop quiz that would not count for me. I began to try and wrap my brain around the new school, new situations, and new people. Why was everyone so scared of Ralphie? Why was everyone even more scared of Kurt? How did someone get a huge cage into a classroom? Why did the teacher seem to have no problem with any of this? Who was Mr. Crumblebean? There was a mystery here, and I probably should have finished the day and begged my mom for homeschooling until seventh grade. But I can't help it. Help was needed. People were scared. I have to get to the truth.